If you have your Bible, join me in Acts chapter 13. We are picking up where we left off last week, but I just want to remind everyone that beginning in October that we'll be changing the format. We will be having an adult Bible study on Wednesday evenings here at the church, going along with our new children's program, Kids Zone Overtime. And so this format will change in a few weeks. Just wanted to remind everyone of that, and we'll keep you up to date each week as we go. But now we're in Acts chapter 13. We pick up where Paul and Barnabas had left. John Mark had gone away. And we saw how that in John Mark, we recognize that there's difficulty in serving the Lord, and that in ministry, sometimes things get hard. And the decision that John made was to leave. But Paul and Barnabas continue on, and the Lord's going to bless their moving forward and his work. So join me, if you will. We're going to be in verse 14. But when they departed from Perga, they came to Antioch into Pisidia and went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and sat down. And after the reading of the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent unto them, saying, Ye men and brethren, if ye have any word of exhortation for the people, say on. So there was a recognition on the part of those that were leaders in the synagogue. They had read out of the law as was customary, and then people were given an opportunity to address those that were in attendance, and most of the time it would have been those that were in the leadership position in that particular synagogue. But at this moment, they see Paul, Barnabas, and they call on them to see if there's anything that they want to say. So then Paul stood up and, beckoning with his hand, said, Men of Israel, and ye that fear God, give audience. At the very beginning here, we're going to see Paul's sermon. And in his preaching, we recognize that Paul's authority was built on the Word of God. He starts off, those of you that fear God, here's my authority. It is not in who I am, it is in God. It does preachers well in every generation to remember that our authority comes from the Word of God. It is why Paul encouraged Timothy to reprove, to rebuke, to exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine in Scripture, because that's where your authority comes from. Continuing on, the God of this people of Israel chose our fathers and exalted the people when they dwelt as strangers in the land of Egypt. And with an high arm brought he them out of it. So he's creating a connection there with his audience. You're Jews, I'm a Jew. We go all the way back to when we were in Egypt, and God had chosen us, and God is the one who brought us to this place. Verse 18. And about the time of 40 years suffered he their manners in the wilderness. And when he destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, he divided their land to them by lot. So now you've got Moses, who's brought the people out of Egypt. Joshua has brought them into Canaan land, verse 20. And after that, he gave unto them judges about the space of 450 until Samuel the prophet. And afterward, they desired a king, and God gave unto them Saul, the son of Cis, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, by the space of 40 years. And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. Now, I don't believe the point of our message tonight in putting this passage in context is to come to David and to look at that, but I don't want to pass over it without drawing at least attention to the fact. This is where we get that statement that David was a man after God's own heart. It shows that in the history of the nation, as Paul was giving this history and using it to draw people to a place in which he could give them the gospel, there were some key facts in the nation's history. We were chosen in Abraham. We became a nation in Egypt. We were brought out of Egypt. We went into the promised land. There's a time of judges, a king, Saul, then David. That's a lot of years of history in just a few words. But he points out that David was this man after God's own heart. Why? Because in David, and David being the man that God wanted there, there was another promise that they could not forget was so important to them. So, verse 23, of this man's seed, David, hath God, according to his promise, raised unto Israel a Savior. There was no one who was of any amount of devoutness to, and pretty much no one in the entire nation who had been raised under the teaching of the Jews, who did not know of David and did not know that there was a promised seed that would come to be the Messiah through David. It was a common knowledge thing. And then he adds the word on at the end of verse 23, Jesus. The Messiah, it was Jesus. You know about it. You knew he was coming. David was the one who was promised to. All of this was clear. We all knew it. And in this moment, we see that Jesus was the one who fulfilled that promise. And then he goes on to validate who Jesus was. When John had first preached before his coming, the baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel. Well, again, people knew John. They respected John. They saw him as a prophet, just like the days of old. And as John fulfilled his course, he said, "Whom think ye that I am? I am not he, but behold, there cometh one after me whose shoes of his feet I am not worthy to loose. Men and brethren, children of the stock of Abraham, and whosoever among you feareth God, to you is the word of this salvation sent." Our Savior, our salvation, our Messiah, Jesus is the answer. "For they that dwell at Jerusalem and their rulers, because they knew him not, nor yet the voices of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath day, they have fulfilled them in condemning him." The prophecy taught that there was this Messiah coming and that people would reject him. And they fulfilled the prophecy. Their own ignorance took the Messiah and fulfilled the prophecy of his death because of who they were. Verse 28, "And though they found no cause of death in him, yet desired they Pilate that he should be slain. And when they had fulfilled all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a sepulcher." Paul going back to that authority position. It was all written ahead of time, and they just fulfilled what was written. The prophets had told us what was going to come. We know it. We've heard it read in the Sabbath day, in the synagogue. They knew it. They just didn't understand. They were the ones behind it. But Jesus died. They took him off the tree. They laid him in a sepulcher. Verse 30. "But God raised him from the dead." And those words are so powerful. "And we declare," well, go back to verse 31. "And he was seen many days of them which came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses unto the people. And we declare unto you glad tidings, how that the promise which was made unto the fathers, God hath fulfilled, the same unto us, their children, in that he hath raised up Jesus again, as it is also written in the second Psalm," giving authority to scripture again here, "Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee." Jesus was the one. Jesus is the one that was written about. He's the one. God raised him from the dead. There are witnesses about this. In this, we see that Paul recognized there is no gospel without Jesus Christ. It was true then. It is true now. We must preach Christ. We preach that he is God, that he came, he died, he was buried, he rose again, according to the scripture. "And as concerning that he raised him up from the dead, now no more to return to corruption, he said on this wise, I will give you the sure mercies of David. Wherefore he saith also in another psalm," more authority, "Thou shalt not suffer thine holy one to see corruption. For David, after that he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell on sleep and was laid unto his fathers and saw corruption." His body went in the ground and it deteriorated. "But he whom God raised again saw no corruption." It's not as if Jesus lived, died again, and is in the grave. Oh no. When he died, within 3 days he was risen, there was no corruption, and he is in glory today. "Be it known unto you therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins." Salvation is in Christ, and by him all that believe are justified, declared righteous from all things. I love that phrase. We're justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. Here in verse 39, we see Christ did what the law could not. To this congregation, this group that's gathered around, the law was supreme. But to them to go, you mean God's gift of the law, the highest level that we have in Christ was above. Christ did what the law couldn't. The law was a schoolmaster, Paul says. It taught us of our need of a sacrifice, of our need of a Savior, our need for the Messiah. And Christ was the Messiah. And now we are justified. Now the temple veil is rent. Now the deed is done. It's finished. Every debt has been paid. And it was all done in Christ. Verse 40. Beware, therefore, lest that come upon you which is spoken of in the prophets. You're the group. You got to be concerned here because they prophesied about what would happen in this situation after the Messiah came. Behold, ye despisers, and wonder and perish, for I work a work in your days, a work which ye shall in no wise believe, though a man declare it unto you. You're missing the very work of God. And this was given to us in Habakkuk. Behold, verse 41, ye despisers. You're despising God. You're despising his great gift. Then in verse 42, and when the Jews were gone out of the synagogue, the Gentiles besought that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath day. The Jews had heard it. The Gentiles hear it. They're like, why don't you come to the outer court where you could preach it to us? We want to hear these truths. We want to understand more. Come back and preach to us again. And the Gentiles are so excited and they're thrilled about that. When you come now to verse 44, and the next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. They came to hear them. You see, in verse 43, they made the promise. Now, when the congregation was broken up, many of the Jews and religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. They heard about God. They heard about the grace. They were growing. They were beginning to learn. They were putting together Christ. And the next week, almost the whole city comes out, and the people gather around. And when the city responds like this, now, instantly, those religious leaders are seeing their way of life threatened. And when their way of life gets threatened, the power of God doesn't matter to them. This has been true of churches throughout history. When a church comes to a place in which it has power in a world and a community that supersedes what God has ordained, that power that they exercise puts them in harm's way. And when they don't yield to what God wants. Here, they had a great knowledge of God, but with everything changing so quickly, they were rejecting the most important truth of all. When we as believers come to the world, we have to make sure that our tradition never gets in the way of our Bible truth. Our society, our Americanism doesn't get in the way of our Christianity. And that we're willing to yield. Well, when this whole city comes together, they begin to see it as a problem instead of an exciting thing. But when the Jews saw the multitudes, this is verse 45, they were filled with envy and spake against those things which were spoken by Paul, contradicting and blaspheming. They begin to blaspheme God. They're speaking bad of Jesus Christ just because of the popularity of the new gospel message that they're getting. Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you. But seeing ye put it from you, and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. The Jews rejected the gospel. Now, I think this is a great little insight into how we see in Scripture the free will of man. We don't see the expression that man has a free will. We see here that man has a choice in his rejecting or accepting Christ. Paul makes it very clear without any question here. But seeing ye put it from you, you did this. You had the gospel. You know the gospel. We've preached to you Jesus Christ, and you have made the decision to put Jesus away. And because of that, you have made yourselves unworthy of everlasting life. The free will of man is illustrated here in the rejecting of salvation. So this is one side of the coin. Gospel's preached. They don't want anything to it. It was their choice. Paul didn't want this for them. Paul wanted them to come to a saving knowledge of Christ. God wants them to come to a saving knowledge of Christ. But in their own arrogance, they reject Christ. But let's continue on. For so hath the Lord commanded us, saying, I have set thee to be a light of the Gentiles, that thou shouldest be for salvation unto the ends of the earth. We had the gospel. We came to bring it to you, and God said, no, they're not going to take it, and so we're going to the Gentiles. You've rejected, so now we're bringing this message to the Gentiles. And when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord. So they hear the message, they glorify the word of the Lord. In other words, they are giving credence to what Paul has said, that Jesus is the Christ. So we could argue that this is the moment at which their minds change and repentance occurs. They have gone from unbelief to belief. And as many as were ordained to eternal life believed. So in this moment, we see now the other side of the coin. So that man has a will and an ability to accept or reject the gospel. The Jews rejected. On the other side, we see a group of people who glorify the word of the Lord. They accept Christ. They believe in him. And in so doing, God, in his foreknowledge, knows ahead of time who will accept and reject. And he ordains them to eternal life. This is not a God predestined individuals who could accept or reject. Clearly, these Jews rejected of their own accord, and Paul clearly teaches that. And then when we look at the other side of that coin, we see how the Gentiles, they're the individuals who have accepted Christ. And because of their glorifying the word of the Lord and because of their accepting of Christ, now they have been given the grace to believe unto salvation. And in that moment, they are ordained, set in order, because there was a foreknowledge of God that knew they would believe in Jesus Christ. It is a great picture of salvation. We see every aspect. The gospel is preached. Christ is magnified. Scripture is used as authority. Some individuals will reject. Some individuals will accept. That is the most difficult aspect of the gospel. Giving is not the most difficult. It's living with the fact that some will reject and some will accept. And I can't make people accept. I will often say when giving some type of an invitation to respond to the gospel, I wish I could believe for you. But I can't make anybody believe. That's a choice you have to make. The Jews rejected, the Gentiles accepted. They were so excited, verse 49, and the word of the Lord was published throughout all the region. The word of the Lord begins to go everywhere. You see, these people now had the truth, and they knew it, and they were excited about it. But the Jews weren't excited. And the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable women, and the chief men of the city, and raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them out of their coasts. They had so rejected Christ that they became angry at the teaching and they pushed them away. As I said a couple weeks ago, why are we ever shocked that the world opposes Christianity? God's work will always face opposition. At this moment, we see this opposition coming and we learn a couple of lessons from it. First of all, we learn opposition can be a source of direction. They were here. They had gone where God had told them. They were preaching the gospel. Now they're pushed out of their coast. They have to go somewhere else. And so we see, but they shook off the dust of their feet against them and came unto Iconium. So they leave here and they go to the next place. When opposition comes, it can be God's way of helping change our direction. Now, this is not as if Paul and Barnabas faced some opposition and they gave up. No. This isn't, well, we'll just leave and go somewhere else. No, they were forced out. There was no choice for them to stay. But at that moment, when they come to the place to where they have to go somewhere else, God uses that to help change their direction. Don't allow opposition to cause you to quit. If there's opposition to the work of the Lord, God may just be using that to move you somewhere else. Don't allow it to cause you to quit. Most people, when they face difficulty, they go, oh, I can't do this, and they quit very easily. Too often, men get out of ministry because they got into the ministry. I'll never forget, I sat at a meal one time with a lady. I'd gone to school with her husband, and after being in ministry for about a year and a half, he had gotten out of it, and he said, well, it just wasn't as fun as I thought it would be. What a terrible reason to get into ministry. And I know too many men who have faced not even really a lot of opposition, but a little opposition in their work for the Lord. And at that moment when they faced that opposition, what they did is they just got out instead of allowing it to change their direction. Allow God to guide. And sometimes he's going to use opposition for that. But there's a sad moment here. When in verse 51, Paul and Barnabas, they shook off the dust of their feet against them and came unto Iconium. They take and say, look, we're done with you. This is a moment in which it's, we don't want your dust on our feet. We're not coming back. When someone rejects Christ to the level that they push away those that are trying to teach them about Christ, often for those that are trying to present Christ, it's very difficult for us because it hurts, because we know what's happened. But ultimately, rejecting Christ is the ultimate self-destructive behavior. We know that there are times in life and situations in which people get themselves into some type of an addiction, some type of a lifestyle, and you try to help them and they really just don't want the help. They keep falling back into it. And there has to come a place to where they decide they want help. And too often we know that means they have to hit rock bottom before they're willing to take help. At this moment, we see for these people, they have come to a place to where they do not want the help of the gospel. If an addict doesn't get help, ultimately it costs them their physical life. It will cost them everything this world has to offer many times. When someone spiritually rejects Jesus Christ, it becomes the ultimate self-destructive behavior because it costs them eternal life in Christ and it costs them hell. Torment for all of eternity is what waits them because of this decision. It is the single worst decision anyone can ever make. And so we plead, we implore, don't make this decision. But there comes a place when someone has made that decision and there's nothing else we can do about it. And so Paul and Barnabas, they just leave. They were not the kind to give up. They'd been forced out. They were not the kind to quit, but they knew these people had made their decision, and now they were going to have to live with the ultimate result of it. Then you come to verse 52. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost. What is great about this is difficulty can't stop joy. I'm sure for Paul and Barnabas, it was defeating having to leave. I'm sure it was disappointing that the Jews had rejected Christ, but many had accepted. The gospel was flourishing. People were taking the truth and spreading it around, and the Gentiles were beginning to come to Christ en masse. And in coming to Christ this way, the joy grew, and the difficulty from one town couldn't take away the joy from the next. The difficulty of some event in life can't take away the joy of walking with the Lord. We can have joy at every stage of our life when we're walking and carrying the gospel with us for the Lord's sake. Hey, take the gospel, carry it with you, preach Christ, use scripture as your authority. Know that man has a choice. He has to make that decision. And for those who reject, I can't carry that burden for them. I can pray, I can be earnest. But they have the ultimate self-destructive behavior if they reject Christ. But for me, I can live in joy knowing that God is working and that His name will be glorified forever and ever. As we come to a time of prayer, do be in prayer for our children's ministry, which is probably going on somewhere around the time you are watching this or after it's already done. We're excited. This will be our first run, and it will be kind of a soft opening, if you will. We'll do the full-blown thing next week and be inviting kids from the community. We want to see young people come to know Christ as Savior and for our influence among young people and their families in our community to grow. So let's be in prayer for that. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the great truths of your word. We thank you for the fact, Father, that we can take the gospel with us everywhere we go, and that when opposition comes, it can just redirect us to where you need us to be, and that the gospel of Jesus Christ is the power of salvation. It was to the Jews first, but it is also now to the Gentiles, to the Greeks, to all of us. And so, Father, we have the great ability of spending eternity with you to be justified, because Christ did what the law could not. And Father, I ask that you will fill us with the joy of our salvation, and that in that joy, we will go about serving you day in and day out. Bless now the Kids Overtime ministry, we pray. Use it. Father, we want to see lives changed. Do not let this become an activity. Let this be a time in which we use different means to get the gospel into the lives of young people and see people walking with you. Father, it is because of Christ we ask these things. Amen. Lord bless you. Have a wonderful evening.